To tell you what our general policy is regarding cancellations. If we can get here, Roger and I, and it looks like we could go ahead, we will do that. That's what we did today. We had the music, and Cecil was kind enough to provide some amplification. But as the weather gets worse and circumstances get more dire, the bottom line is don't ever think you have to endanger yourself to get to church. If it's hard for you to get up and get out, don't get up. Don't get out. We'll see you the next week, particularly in snowstorms and other things. We just don't know. Some part of the city might look fine. Other parts, or if you're out a bit in the country, might not look as good. So please don't ever think you have to put yourself at risk or whatever to get here. If church is on, it's on, and some will be here to carry on, and we will see you when you get here. The announcements for today are in the bulletin. Not a lot to remind you of, other than there's a congregational meeting next week. Please let folks know that we will be presenting the 2024 budget following the service. That will be a long time, but an opportunity for you to look at the budget, to ask any questions that may occur when you see the figures, and that will go ahead. Thank you to those who have begun our preparations for Christmas. Some of the things that were up there are now down here, and as the weeks go by, the decorations for Advent and Christmas will go up. That is, as most things here, a community effort, people coming and doing what they can. Another part of our preparation for Advent and Christmas is to begin our charitable projects. A reminder, I think I misinformed you last week and said the money in the little can there is going to the food bank. I think it's going to feed the need, but the food bank is benefiting from your generosity and kindness through the donation of food over the season. Mary, did you want to say anything about it?
No, just that the men are going to bring the food forward.
They will.
And we're going to ask for a blessing upon it, and hope that it multiplies.
Okay, so that's please, guys. Yeah.
Just to remind everybody that it doesn't have to be a big thing, long as it's something that you can bring each and every Sunday. There's a great need.
And if you're thinking, gee, this started a little early, you're right, it did start a little early. It's usually at Advent. But the need, as you can imagine, is really pressing this year. So the earlier that we can get a start, the better. So let's bow for a moment of prayer. Holy God, we thank you for this opportunity to be generous, to share from our wealth with those who are finding these difficult times, are bearing on them. We feel it as well, but we ask you to multiply the generosity of giving in our hearts in this season and always. Amen. Take a moment then to light our candle. And we join in our prayer. We light this candle as a sign of God's Spirit at work in the world. May its light brighten our spirits. May the light of God shine through us, bright in the world. Silent before our God.
God brings judgment against oppressors, against all who misuse earth's resources.
The great day of God is near. It brings distress to those alienated from God.
God breaks the weapons of war and strips away the advantages of the comfortable.
God has not destined us for wrath, but for salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ.
We gather in faith and hope and love to encourage one another.
Let us worship God together. Please be seated and continue with me as in unison we offer our prayer approach. God of judgment, the whole earth bows in fear before you. Who will deliver us from your wrath? Before your majesty, the mountains sway. Before your anger, we are filled with terror. We who have taken your love for granted are stunned by the judgment that causes us. We are shaken, yet strangely reassured by a God who wants only the best for us. Lead us here to turn us from our sinful ways. Amen. Our hymn of praise is 412, 412 in Voices United. This is the day.
Good morning. first reading today is from Judges chapter 4, verses 1 through 7, Deborah. Again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, now that Ehud was dead. So the Lord sold them into the hands of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. Sisera, the commander of his army, was based in Harosheth Hagoyim, because he had 900 chariots fitted with iron and had cruelly oppressed the Israelites for 20 years. They cried to the Lord for help. Now Deborah, a prophet, the wife of Lapidoth, was leading Israel at that time. She held court under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites went up to her to have their disputes decided. She sent for Barak, son of Abinom, from Kadesh in Naphtali, and said to him, "The Lord, the God of Israel, commands you, go take with you 10,000 men of Naphtali and Zebulun, and lead them up to Mount Tabor. I will lead Sisera, the commander of Jabin's army, with his chariots and his troops, to the Kishon River, and give him into your hands." And our responsive psalm is in Voices United, page 847, Psalm 123. Are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, as always, to our choir for their ministry of music. It is always appreciated. We continue with our gospel reading this morning, and this is one of the few remaining lessons from Matthew's gospel before we move into another year of the lectionary, where the emphasis will be on Mark. But today, Matthew 25, verses 14 to 30, these are the words of our Lord. "For it is if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with the 2 talents came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping gnashing of teeth.' God add a blessing to this and every reading from God's holy word. Amen." Just before our message, we do want to welcome those who may be joining our service later in the day via the recording that is taking place. I may look a little bigger today in the picture because I'm a little bit closer. I'm not up there because we do not have electricity at the church, so everyone is huddled in their coats and listening attentively for the words of the sermon. Let's bow together in prayer. Lord, in these words, may we find your word and so your gift of abundant and everlasting life through Christ, our Savior and friend. Amen. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in the darkness so that the day should surprise you like a thief. You are children of light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night and to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. One of the challenges circulating on Facebook last week was to recall one's earliest memory of a major news story. For me, it was the assassination of President Kennedy on November 22, 1963. I was 12 years old, just starting junior high. The principal came on the PA system to say the president had been shot, and it could mean that World War III was happening, so we better go home. We were more excited to have the day off than worried about World War III. But grown-ups were concerned, because it was generally understood in the 1960s that a third world war would be a nuclear war, and that it would be the end of the world. Indeed, it was revealed a few years ago, when some classified documents were declassified, that the world came a lot closer to the brink of war during the Cuban Missile Crisis in 1962 than the public knew for decades following. And of course, we who were little never gave a second thought, and adults breathed a sigh of relief, but that was a good time, I guess, to be in the darkness. Since that time, of course, there have been, to quote scripture, wars and rumors of wars, and the possibility of nuclear annihilation is so familiar that we really don't give it much thought. Even now, with the old Cold War enemy Russia in a prolonged war with Ukraine, and brutal conflict raging in the Middle East and in other parts of the world, there are warnings about how close we might be to an escalation to World War III. But we carry on resolutely, if not cheerfully, with our daily lives. Needless to say, humanity has been through it many times before. The end of the world was a common theme in the past when cataclysmic upheaval affected all of humanity or a large portion of humanity. Whether it was COVID a few years ago, previous pandemics like the Spanish flu of 1918, a bright comet appearing in the sky, or those wars that engulfed every nation in World War I and II. In all of those situations, and perhaps in our current crisis, some Christian folks may well ask, are things so bad that God in Christ must step in to declare it all over, but folks going off to their eternal fate? It's fair, I think, that to say that there may be people eager to hear Gabriel blow the trumpet, and eyes looking skyward for Jesus to appear in the clouds. More than a few Christians pray for it. Is it a radical thought to suggest that we should all be praying that prayer? As the season of Advent approaches, the preparation time for celebrating the birth of Christ, one of the traditional prayers of our faith is indeed one word, Maranatha, which means return, Lord. Return and save us all from this misery. In the readings for this Sunday after Pentecost, and with just a couple of Sundays to Advent, we perceive that same longing, this same hope that the end, if not near, is at least coming, and with it the fulfillment of our faith. We declare that God cares for us daily, but we trust God will take care of us forever. Wars and rumors of wars may be causing misery for many, that no future looks better than an event that ends history and begins eternity. The perspective of the first Christians, of course, was vastly different than our own. In that time that Paul wrote his letter to the first Christians in Thessalonica and other Roman towns, there were people who were alive, or whose parents were alive, when Jesus walked the earth. The record of Jesus' ministry, his words and actions, and his promises were still fresh in the minds of his followers, so much so that most were convinced a second coming would occur in their lifetime. It's hard even to get into that mental space to think that it's so urgent that, gee, I don't have to worry too much about the future, because before I even die, the Lord may come and we'll understand it all by and by. However, people did start to pass away without the Lord returning, so much so that Paul and other church leaders were compelled to address this genuine distress. They did so with reference to stories Jesus himself told, such as the parable of the talents we read a few moments ago, and with invitations to consider that God's perspective on matters like time might be different than our own. The bottom line was that Christ would return when he would return. No one knew and no one knows the time but the Father, but everyone should be ready at all times. And getting ready, as the parable notes, is not a matter of packing a bag and sitting on a bench at the bus station or airport. It's a matter of having the world in some kind of reasonable shape to present to Christ when he arrives. The parable of the talents, like all the parables, has many lessons to teach. But one major one is that God provides each person with talents. Not the money cited in the story, but our modern meaning of the word. Innate abilities to accomplish things in the world. And we have no doubt that some folks have more talent than others. Everyone, though, has the choice, as described in the parable, to simply do nothing and have Jesus find the world pretty much as he left it, that is in a mess because of selfishness and greed, or take the power Jesus passed to us in the presence of the Holy Spirit to use our time and our talent as best we can at every opportunity, to show loving kindness in the ways that we are able to, with our talents, with our time, simply with our devotion to the needs of others. It's not easy to do. I have a story. I have lots of stories from Isaac. Here's another story from Isaac. One day a few weeks ago, we took Isaac to the local store to get some candy, and it just happened that he went in ahead of us, and there were some bigger boys there who saw a little boy and decided, well, there's a little boy, that's our opportunity to be mean to someone. So they were kind of teasing him, and he got his candy, but he was a little upset, and when we got home, he said, why were they mean to me? I'm one of the heaven people. I didn't quite say, that's who they're meanest to. They just said, well, you know, they're just like that, and you, if you're one of the heaven people, you strive to not be like that, and so on and so forth. But it's true. We're coming here today, you're setting yourself aside. That's saying to people, I'm a Christian, or I'm one of the heaven people. People are going to start looking at you in a different way, and we hope have higher expectations, because God himself in Christ has higher expectations and has given us the opportunity with our talents, with our determination, and with our gift of the Spirit to apply those talents to the world. Please use your talents to the best of your ability, but always have in mind that the truth, that the greatest talent available always and inexhaustibly to everyone, is the ability to love and serve others. And it's a talent and gift that is most obvious in times like these when the human spirit is tested. It is easy and understandable to give up and to give over to despair when we see all that goes on in the world. But we conclude today with a higher truth in which we find strength and hope. The time of the Lord's return is not a high priority for his disciples, because God in Christ never left. The Holy Spirit remains and abides through all time, infinite and finite, and it dwells exceedingly and mightily in the human heart. Let its light shine from you, that others may see and rejoice. Let us pray. Lord, we understand that we live in difficult times, as humanity has always lived through. But help us to know that these times are in your hands, as we are. There is always an opportunity to love and serve you and others. In your dear name. Amen. And our hymn. Fresh words in your bulletin, the tune will be familiar. Oh God, we yearn for safety. now to join in a time of prayer, the spoken prayer and the shared prayer. Please ask from your heart, add what is needed in your life these days. Let us bow together. Loving and generous God, we thank you for this opportunity, and we thank you that we are indeed with Isaac, heaven people, that we are called to make heaven on earth as best we can, to show the loving kindness that was shown to us in the sacrifice, the life, the teaching, the suffering, the death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Remind us daily that he abides with us as you do, Lord, in the presence of your Holy Spirit, that this is indeed a real and present power to do good, to resist evil, and to establish your kingdom here on earth. It is a kingdom not ruled by power and greed, but by compassion and care. Help us to establish that kingdom in our homes, in the places where we work, in all our reactions and all our hopes for relationships close and far away. Help us to know that the opportunities given to be part of the wider world in modern technology are again an avenue for your love and care. We encounter in these ways of communicating so much hatred and suspicion. Help us to counter those with messages of care and love. Lord, we ask for your prayer in those places for those people in conflict, in places where there is war and suffering. We do think of the Middle East. We are reminded in our scripture that it has been a place of war, as all places from a time immemorial. Help us to know that though that seems to go on forever, that it can end as the world wars ended, as conflicts have been resolved. Help us to work for and pray for that day when there will be peace in Ukraine, where there will be peace in the Middle East, where there will be no need for refugees to flee, but where humanity dwells together in peace and hope. Help us never to lose sight of that day, for it is your hope and wish as well. We ask, Lord, that you would be near and dear to those in our church family, those gathered today, those at home or in hospital, those facing illness or the end of this world and the beginning of your grace in eternity. Our thoughts and prayers are with each one we know. Our prayer is offered in the presence and power of Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And as we turn to a time of appreciation for support of the church, we have a mission and service message. Welcome.
Mission and service message this morning is kindergarten in a refugee camp. Hundreds of children have graduated from JCC kindergarten program. Being a child in a refugee camp means facing lots of uncertainty at a very young age. In addition to food and water being scarce, education is generally not easy accessible. Some children were born in the camps, while others fled with their families at a very young age. Either way, living in a refugee camp means children may not learn crucial conscientious and social skills. Since 1950, the Joint Christian Commission for Social Services has provided skills, training, and services to refugees living in refugee camps in Lebanon. One of their incredible initiatives is kindergarten program, where children can engage in learning in a happy and secure place. Hundreds of children have graduated from JCC kindergarten program with skills they need to survive.
After graduating, children continue in schools that welcome the basic knowledge and values they have learned. Your generosity through mission and service help keep these children learning all year round. Thank you.
Accept our sacrifices, O God, for we bring them with joy.
Receive our thanks for all the mercies granted us by your divine majesty.
May you be glorified by these gifts, even as they encourage us in our work together. May the ministries they enable carry good news to many who will never know. Amen.
Thank you to all who planned and participated in our service today. To our closing as we join in singing 509.